principle, the repository, and then it's pretty much configuring the new servers and running process. And after that, it should probably be good. I'll start while I'm doing it. So,
let the adventure begin.
Can we start the timer now, or?
Yeah, no, you can start with that. 15:26.
Probably because when we're talking, I'll probably be distracted in there. And that's the one thing.
How?
So, for those of you who don't know, you know, it's a private server provider that has very high quality stuff. And it has a new server. Luckily, I don't have a trade for this shit. So I just spent $1,700 in my client money. So then the pretty cool, you just select the location where you want them, they can choose any data center. So put them in London.
London. So
64-bit Debian. Generate a
root password.
Let's read those. I've got a private IP here. And I will put it into the support report. This is why you pay a bunch of money for Linux. As you will see, they will, if we're lucky, they will respond within pretty much. Usually they're within 6 minutes and done. Like, I have no idea, and it's not an actual human being, because they want to know why you want expert ID. So I put in the request now, and last time I did it, before I started booting up the servers, I can actually see the IPs here already.
How does this compare to AWS?
It's not. These servers are actual virtual private. They're actually virtual virtual machines. You all send them on a physical machine. And the advantage of we notice that you have guaranteed performance. So they're running on battery back, hardware rated machines. So you have real performance and not old. You can see here in the bottom, you see the job queue, you can see the jobs that they create, but you set up the machines and configure them, and my name, pretty much everything is default. team, not going to be part of the not by the public. First of all, adding to the host farm. If you see me do anything weird, then it's the screen.
Cool.
So this is just a whole file, we should actually put this in the last at some point, but for now it's not really necessary. Because now they'll tell them that they have one IP and they should have two IPs. And so basically for MySQL for the MMM stuff you need two virtual IPs, one for the reader, for all the read queries and one for the write queries. We have, we already have a streamer at MMM cluster, so I'll add a fourth one. So we made a define that made it possible to have only this set up and configure a whole cluster. So copy this and three cluster.
Or before we move on.
So the environment I'm using is a Eclipse. I'm not a big fan of Eclipse, but I am a big fan of the Jupyter, which is freaking awesome. So you're using Puppet a lot, and you write a lot of Puppet recipes, and Jupyter will make a lot of locking.
Oh, yeah.
It understands your goals of like doing more work, and then it sees that it's doing better at IDE. There it is, the second time you've already done it. So you pay for that kind of service at the and the question is whether it's worth it for your whatever you want. But they have, for instance, an IRC channel that you can ask questions. So just visit that and hopefully you hang out there as well. So that makes it actually quite convenient if you want to ask any questions. You can directly address them in the IRC channel. Especially when there's a downtime or some stuff like that. But there are parts of this that are ready for improvement. For instance, what I'm doing next is the meetup front file. They should be templated so that you can actually use the meetup front file that is same for every cluster. So it would make sense to not have now eight copies of the same file with minor things lying around. But it's a great business. So the only change is the thing that has changed here on the server ID. Now the last thing we need to do is add the nodes to the library of known nodes, which is done here. All we need to do is drop it here. This part. So we have store this stuff in a separate database. All the facts that you're using in a repository, you can actually store them outside of the repository, so that you don't have to put the IP address here. That would mean that put the IP address that I copied into like three or four different locations now, and actually put them into one location in a separate database, and then the repository actually pull it out of the platform right there. Thank you.
here. Probably got to be about here. And then we're ready to if you're using a Mac and you need Git, then this tool, well, the source tree is awesome. Mm-hmm. You should not spend another day with it. It's good to know your Git commands, but making it visual, you can do stuff here, like inside the Git, you can say, oh, I want on this line. So you can say, I'm saying just those two lines. Cherry picking becomes easy instead of now there cannot be any mistakes in this rather than 25 people watching me. So they have two data centers, and they're moving from the Amsterdam data center to the London data center. So now I run sockets here in order to pull in the new host files as well as the new servers. They run a socket with store configuration, so all the packs of every server are stored in a central location. But now I run Python, and you can see here the host file being updated. Interactively, you can see that it's you can get a diff on the command line of what has been changed. And now I can do to log into the public IP first because the private IP hasn't been configured yet, which is something I'll do tonight. Okay, so here are my two new servers. As you can see, they still have the default host name, and I need to change that, and I need to tell them where the public master is going to be able to run the public correctly. So, I can run this beautiful function I can have out all the input go to both to all tabs, which is cool if you know what you're doing, and if you're not paying attention, it can also be extremely distracting. And I've pulled it off once to actually reboot 7 database servers. Which, surprisingly enough, yields very unhappy clients. It's one of those things that, you know, you do them and you go, oh crap, did I really just do that? Because no one's talking. So that is one thing. Time zones. This part strictly comes to time zones. So when it comes to time, so make sure you set the time correctly. Be the HTTP for now, and a little later configure them to be static. Because Puppet only runs on the private network, so we'll need to bring up the private interface before we can actually run Puppet over it. So next up is installing the standard Puppet agents. The other thing that's one of the other things that's really cool is that it comes, for instance, with a remote terminal that runs on Android. So now the machines are back. Now the next thing we do is we install the standard amplifier and the Puppet Labs maintain their own amplifier, which is very, very nice because it's always updated and it is very nice stuff. So yeah, and they also keep the latest, the last 5 versions or whatever, it's quite effective on that. Mm-hmm.
And then we're almost there. You know, I can install a pop-up manufacturer.
Factor is a little utility that's used by a pop-up to gather information about the machine that it's running on. That will be reported to the pop-up master so that it can know. The last thing we need to do is modify the config by a little bit. And then I guess we are ready to sign. Now we sign the certificates. So we run the first time puppet runs, it will connect with the puppet master and we'll try to identify. The puppet master will say, hey, wait, I've never seen you before. Why should I trust you? So you need to manually find the machine on the puppet master. So here I am back on the puppet master and I have the puppet cert and sign. And for A, and for B. Now we can run top and sit back and sip coffee. And the person starts synchronizing the logins. The public repository is not perfect yet. There are a few small things that we'll need to do. The good thing is that now I don't need to do anything. I just sit back and the machine will be compared exactly the same way as all the other ones. So we'll be exactly the same performance given the same load. It's going to take like 5 minutes, I think. You can see everything specified. Purple is not good. It means that, for instance, here, I'm requiring not to be able to go to the input admin, and then my cell is missing, which means that there is a missing dependency link between creating that database user and actually having my cell installed, which is not really a problem. We just run Puppet files for maybe 3 times. One of the things about Puppet is that even though you write, for instance, let's say, these 3 things, class, memory master, memory interface, network interface, it doesn't mean that they will actually get applied in that order. It could be applied in this order on one run, and then the next step you can run it again, and it can take completely different order. It builds a dependency graph based on what you define as actual dependencies. So, here, for instance, it says require. By using the word require, you actually build in an actual dependency. So I say here that before you apply this resource test repository, you actually need to put in a key. If you don't, it could very well be that you start putting the key before the repository or the other way around. So things that pop up here, it's a bit nasty because it pops up here. Problems, whereas in my development server, they might have never popped up as a problem. You can simply happen to be logging 20 times in a row when the defendant user in the right order, and the 21st time you're not rushing. And once it has one of the things that it does, that Shopper does on the process master, is build a dependency graph of all the resources that you set up to apply to your server. And when it's applying the actual dependency graph, it finds problems, it will skip applying all the dependencies on that node and all the children in the dependency tree. So then you'll see stuff like this popping up, skipping because of failed dependencies, which usually is not that much of a problem. Do you guys see anything popping up that is ready for improvement? More than happy to hear about. Report is not a problem because we haven't set up the REST interface in the report yet. So, lightning round button again. I won't start my spell because the configuration files that we are using have a different log file form or size in it, so we adjust that before we actually start. Is my monitoring service, so we have sections that are in data stage and they're not signed yet, so that's why.
Installed manually.
You can get anything, we're looking at what files on an existing server. It's not a good idea, but it's brand new. Notice that I don't actually restart myself, I'm just a puppet handler. So in puppet I define that my scale should be running. So when it's doing this puppet run now, it'll check, hey, if my scale is not running, I'll just start it for you. Because you don't really need this command. Normally, if you're not in a hurry, you can wait. It runs once every half an hour, so you can wait for an hour and a half or 2 hours or whatever. You can actually do that, but for a full puppet function, you need to contact the puppet master with all the packages, the whole catalog that's compiled, one puppet function that comes back and it can only track it actually compiled. So as you see now, there's no more errors. Done. So we're all good. The next part of the process is my spell. Well, it's already there. I have special process. I think at least. Definitely, I'm going to stand down the side of the show. Really impressive. Also, again, normally you need to make sure that there's no rest after before you do this, but I know that there is no rest, and I think that so now we have replication, which is basically just one command. You use the password that I put in the cluster file down here.